Often, data sets come in large sizes. So to use and analyze it, we first need to organize data. In this video, we're going to talk about one of the ways to organize quantitative data, and that is constructing a frequency and relative frequency tables. We're actually going to combine these two tables into one. To see how it's done, we're going to use the following example. Here we have a data set that represents average household income after taxes for a sample of 25 out of the 50 states in 2009 in thousands of dollars. So that means that each number in this data set represents average household income in thousands of dollars for one out of 25 states. Right away, you can see that it's pretty hard to intake this information when it's presented to us as the list of numbers. And it's only 25 numbers. Can you imagine if we had 2,500 numbers? So let's organize this data and put it in the frequency and then relative frequency table. For that, we're going to split this data set into groups. However, in statistics, instead of saying groups, we usually use word classes. So we're going to create classes. So each class is going to look like a range of two numbers from two. Now, what is the first number that we have to use here? By the way, this first number has the name. It's called the lower class limit. Generally, the lower class limit for the first class is either the smallest observation in the data set or a convenient number slightly lower. For this particular example, I'm actually given the lower class limit to use. It says 30, so I'm going to place it here. But I can also confirm that it's a good idea by looking at the data set and finding the smallest observation. Well, I think that's this one, 30.1. So 30 is slightly below, and it's indeed the only convenient number to use. Well, now, what's going to be the next number or the second number in this range? I'm going to actually leave it blank for now, because what I'm going to do, I'm going to move to the next class. Well, this is called the first class, now it's going to be the second class. And I start by determining the lower class limit for the second class. And that number is determined by what's called the class width. So the class width is basically the difference between two consecutive lower class limits. Now, for this example, once again, I am given the class width. It's class width of 5. Right here. That means that the lower class limit for the next class, for the second class, should be 35. And that's basically taking the preceding lower class limit and adding class width, so plus 5, which is class width. And this way I can find the next lower class limit, so that's 40, right? Because it's plus 5 again. As I already said, I am given the class width to use for this example, but what if the class width is not given and you need to decide and determine it on your own? Well, then, these are the steps you want to do. So first, you need to decide on the number of classes. How many categories like that do you want to create? And usually we use between 5 and 15 classes. And it depends on the size of the data set. So the smaller the data set, the fewer classes you should have. And once you decide on how many classes you want to have, then you're going to use the following simple formula to calculating class width. So here it is. To calculate class width, you find the difference between the largest data value and the smallest data value. By the way, this is also called range. And then you divide by the number of classes that you want to have. And then when we perform these steps, then we want to make sure to round up to a convenient number. So in other words, no matter what result we got, we don't follow the regular rules for rounding. We always round up in this case. Okay, so let's continue with setting up the classes. Now let's determine what we call the upper class limit. So that's the number that we have to place here at the end of the range. Well, the idea is that there should be no gaps between classes. So that means that if I know that second class starts with 35, the preceding class should end with, well, you would say 34. And that would be totally fine to write 34. But to make this table even more convenient to work with, it would be good to look at the way the data is given to us. So notice that all values in this data set have one decimal place. So that means that instead of 34, I'm going to put 34.9. It will just make it easier to work with this table and placing all these values in the right classes. Okay, so the next upper class limit is 39.9, and I need to decide how many classes I'm going to end up with. Well, since again, I was given the class width. Let's see what's the largest data value in our set. I believe it's 54.4, so that means that we need to keep going with classes. So 40, the next lower class limit will be 45, then it's going to be 50, and that should be good enough because the upper class limits are 44.9, 49.9, and here it's going to be 54.9. So I will be able to place the largest data value into this class. So that means that we end up with five classes. Okay, so once we create this kind of categories, we need to fill out a column that's called frequency. Now, what is frequency? Well, basically, frequency is the number of observations in each class. So frequency is answering question, how many? In other words, I need to count how many observations in this data set are between 30 and 34.9, and so on and so forth. And for this kind of counting, we're going to use tallies. So we're just really going to go one by one through this data set. So 30.1. So 30.1 belongs to this first class. So I'm going to put tally mark. Then 35.5. That's the second class. I put tally mark. And so on and so forth. 41.3. That's the third class. So I'm going to do that quickly and then we'll continue. So this is what I got for tally marks. And now I just have to record frequency. So it's 5 plus 3, 8. Another 8, 4, 3, and 2. So frequency tells me how many observations from the data set is in each class. Once you record in frequency, the very good idea to do at this point is to double check if those numbers add up to the right total. So if I add 8 plus 8, 16, 20, 23, 25. So if I add them up, I will get total 25. And that will help me, well, give me a chance to catch mistakes. And I remember that we're given here information about 25 states. So that means that there is a good chance that we counted observations correctly and placed them in the right classes. And that's pretty much what frequency table looks like. It contains classes and corresponding frequencies. But there's also one important term that comes with frequency table, and it's called frequency distribution. So when we list categories or classes and the corresponding frequencies, this is called frequency distribution. So we basically can see a better picture of how data are partitioned among those classes or categories. Next, let's expand this table and add another column that we call relative frequency. So what is the difference between frequency and relative frequency? Well, frequency represents a number of observations in each class, each category. In other words, it answers the question, how many? Relative frequency represents proportion of those observations in each class. So I wrote it here. But remember, to find proportion, we have to take part and divide by the total. And in this case, part refers to the number of observations in each class, in other words, frequency. So to calculate relative frequency for each class, we have to take frequency for that class and divide by the total number of observations. So in our case, 25. So 8 over 25, that's going to be relative frequency. But more often, we don't leave it as a fraction. We rather convert it to a decimal. So if I divide 8 by 25 using calculator, I'll find that it's same as 0.32. 32 hundredths. So that represents relative frequency. But since it might not be that easy to intake information in this kind of form as the decimal, we take one step further and we convert this decimal to percentage. So remember, to convert decimal to percent, we just have to take decimal point and move it two places to the right. So if I place decimal point here, it becomes 32%. And now as we see relative frequency in terms of percentage, it's a little bit easier to intake this information. So basically it says that 32% of states among those 25 have average household income between 30,000 and 34,900. So that's the idea of the relative frequency's proportion. Let's move on with the rest of the classes. So next one is the same, 8 over 25. That's 32%. Now for the third class, it's 4 over 25. And that is 0.16, which is, if I move decimal point two places to the right, I'll get 16, so 16%. So 16% of states among those 25 have average household income after taxes in 2009 between $40,000 and $44,900. So you got the idea. So I'm gonna add the other two. Okay, so I got all relative frequencies, and at this point, again, it's another checkpoint. That would be a good idea to add either relative frequencies in terms of decimals or in terms of percentages. So can you guess what I should get? If I add up all those percentages, what would be the right number to get? Well, it should be 100%, of course, right? And if I add decimals, I should get 1. So, and that is indeed what we're getting if we add either decimals or percentages. Okay, so that's how you compute relative frequency. And relative frequencies, along with the corresponding classes, represent relative frequency distribution. So similar idea. Here we talked about frequency distribution. Now we can talk about relative frequency distribution. So that is the way to organize, or one of the ways to organize, quantitative data. By constructing frequency distribution or relative frequency distribution tables. And next, using these tables, we can construct a special graph that's called histogram. We're gonna see how it's done in the next video.